quickly. So let's start. Good. So the agenda will be, I tell you something about what was before Scrum, so traditional project management types. And after that, I go through to explain you something about Scrum. Then I go into more details and give you an overview about Scrum elements. And at the same time, I have a Scrum example. We are making right now an update for GP. It's the Global Event Publisher from Autodesk. And I can show you some examples from that, how to proceed with that in Scrum. So let's start. What was before Scrum? I don't know, but I guess everybody of you knows the traditional waterfall project management style. That means that you start planning in the beginning, so you get all the requirements, you are thinking about the design, and in this example it would be, for example, a one-year project, and you need almost 4 months just for the planning. Then you start with the coding, then you get into the integration. After that, you have testing, and in the end, you deploy the program. And so you see, you have almost 1 year until you really can launch the product, and it's the earliest moment where the customer or the market can see the product. So yeah, you need to plan a lot in the beginning. And to be successful with this project management style, because it's successful over decades, or it was successful over decades, you need following requirements. It's the project manager have to do all the analysis in the beginning. So he has to know everything in front of the project. And yeah, he needs perfect knowledge about every requirement, about all the changings which could occur during this implementation process. And very important, he can never make mistakes during this process, because if you like to change something, you have to go back to the beginning, make change requests and all the stuff. So it's for complex projects, it's very difficult to be successful with this kind of project management. So why is it like that? It's because the time has changed. Everything is moving faster. I guess everybody of you knows that if you buy, for example, a computer, one day after you bought it, it's already old. The software is going so fast, and even the hardware. So it's not like decades ago that it's a little bit smoother within the environment and everything. Everything is going faster today. So we have to change our way of thinking and maybe to look for other possibilities. And for your understanding, I have here an analysis from the Standish Group. It's located in Boston, and they are doing analysis for software projects since 1985. So it's a well-known group. And you see here, they were analyzing the waterfall methodology, and you can see just 14% of the projects today are successfully. So that means that there are absolutely no problems, that the software launch is very smooth, and it's just successful. You see 57% are challenged, means that they reach the goal, so they can launch the project, but with delays or some kind of trouble during the project management, and so it's not an easy launch. And it's almost 30% which failed, so it's a very high number of projects which are not successful. So you see, this analysis already shows that the time has changed, and so also we have to change our way of thinking. So that's a good point to a good moment to explain you something about Scrum. As was said, we are doing Scrum also here in our company for several projects, and we are quite satisfied with the process. To explain you the definition of Scrum, I picked something out of the internet. It's Scrum is a simple framework for effective and team collaboration on complex projects. And I think the most important part of the sentence is complex projects. It's today we have, yeah, in the most cases we have complex projects. They are customers are changing their or market are changing their requirements, and it's everything is moving faster. And as you see, the word Scrum is coming from rugby, the definition. So Scrum is a situation in a rugby game where all the team players putting their arm over each other and pushing or trying to pushing the other team away from the ball to reach the ball. So it's all about teamwork. And that's is what Scrum is also in this project management methodology. Here you have a slide which should visualize how Scrum works. You remember the slide before with the waterfall project management style? You have all these different to-dos during a process. You also have to do it at Scrum too, of course. But at Scrum, you do everything at the same time. So you just throw all the to-dos in a mixer. Can imagine it like that. And then you generate iterations called sprints. Means all the stuff which you're doing during the whole year or the whole project, which was 1 year, you're doing just for a shorter time period. Means that all the planning is, of course, a little bit before, but all the planning, design, coding, testing, it's everything done during a time period of a sprint. It's between 2 or 4 weeks. And after that, this package of the software is finalized. So it means you have several iterations which is doing all the stuff which is usually done in 1 year, but just for the most important features. So you have sprint one. After that, you start sprint two. So you continue your planning for requirements and all the stuff during the first sprint and put it into the second sprint and the third sprint and the fourth sprint. I come to this back later in other slides and go more into detail for this. Yeah, what are the key benefits of Scrum? You have a better quality. It's, I think, very important also for the customer to say what's the real advantage for us as a customer. And better quality means a team is in Scrum organizing itself. So you put all the experiences from a team together and you share it in cross-functional teams. Means it's not only an individualist of a developer, it's more developers in one team, so they talk much together and share their information and their experience. I think pair programming is a kind of programming which is famous right now because of the sharing of the experiences. Furthermore, the team is reflecting their processes during a sprint. Means after every sprint, they are coming together in a meeting and talking about what went well, what went not good, and what do we have to improve. So after every iteration, you try to make the process better. And also you start working faster and get a better quality. The second part is more transparency. Means for the customer and all the people who are involved in this process, it's more transparency. Because after every iteration, after every sprint, you get a feedback from the team. You get the product increment demonstrated. And you see in a very early version if the project is like you wanted to have it, or if you would like to have to change something. And you easily can change something because you can tell the company your new requirements and you can already implement it in the next sprint. So you have a lot of iterations and transparency during the different sprints. Yeah, inter-visibility is a point of the team's progress, so you have a kind of wish list which is prioritized, which you can always see, and you can also take action as a customer, which are the most important tasks. And it's a high communication level, so everyone is trying to share their information, and there's a lot of communication during this process, which is in the most projects one of the most difficult part, to have a good communication. And the last point, or the third point, is to save time and money, because the team regularly delivers just the most valuable features to generate an early time for go-to-market. So it's not, you need just 1 year until you go to market. You can go to an early moment on the market when you think, okay, after 4, 5, or 6 sprints, the most important features are already implemented. So it's already possible to go to market, and even without nice to have features or features which are not so important for the customer, that you can maybe bring into the product in a second or third release. I think Apple is a good example for that. They launched their products, I guess in the last software it was the card system. It was not not completely done, but they already had to bring the phone on the market and get the revenue out of it, and they made updates of the card. So it was more important to get a quick launch than to make the product completely done. It's not so important, because you can make updates in these times. Good. And here is the best example why Scrum should be the project management tool. It's again an analysis from the Standish Group, and you see on the right upper corner you can compare it to the numbers of the waterfall project management type. It's the Scrum software projects are 42% successful, so it's way better than at waterfall. You have 49% challenged projects. Of course, Scrum is not a solution for everything, but you can see it's an absolute improvement, and just 9% failed. So I think this analysis is saying everything about the benefits of Scrum. Good. Here's some keynotes. It's when you talk about Scrum, it's you hear always the names here, Jeff Sutherland and Ken Schwaber. They are kind of founder of the methodology. And every time when you hear something about Scrum and the founders, you will hear these names. And what's very interesting is the statistic. They were asking 4,000 software professionals, and 72% of them are already practicing Scrum or some kind of hybrid. So it's very common in software development, and yeah, we are not the first one. Good. Let's go more into details. I will do the Scrum elements and the example I prepared for you. At first, I would like to give you a quick overview about the whole process of Scrum. It's a little bit, maybe a little bit much on one slide, but it's the process like it is. So try to follow me. It's at first it starts always with an requirement from a customer. Let's say Autodesk has an order to One Media, so they have a contact person, the project manager, or in Scrum words, the product owner, who is communicating with Autodesk and getting all the requirements Autodesk would like to have for this project. So he's writing all the requirements in the product backlog, which is a kind of wish list where all the features are listed, and the product owner is, depending on the requirement of the customer, is prioritizing each product backlog item. So each feature is prioritized, and the product owner is writing user stories to each product backlog item. So he's looking very much to the user point of user perspective. So it's not that the PO is making technical tasks, he's just the eye of the user, let's say it like this. After that, the product backlog was created. He goes to the software development team from One Media, and he's going there and have a sprint planning meeting and explaining the development team what every product backlog item is about. So the team can ask questions, and the product owner can explain everything around this user story. And after that, the team is estimating every product backlog item, so how long they will need for implementation, and they are grabbing just the most prioritized or the top prioritized product backlog items out of the product backlog and move it into their sprint backlog. In the sprint backlog, they will generate to each product backlog item subtasks, technical subtasks, which they can use for implementation. And then they are going into the first sprint. The sprint will be defined, the length means 2, 3, or 4 weeks. It's up to the product owner. And they will implement during this iteration all the features they grabbed out of the product backlog. And every day they come together, the team, and have a daily Scrum meeting. Means they are talking just about what they have done yesterday, what they will do today and tomorrow until the next daily Scrum, and if they have any impediments. I go more into details of the meetings in the next slides. So at the end of the sprint, they hand over the potential shippable product after the sprint to the product owner or customers or stakeholders. They can also be involved in this process during the sprint review meeting. They hand over the shippable product, and yeah, PO can see the product in a very early version. And the last meeting is the retrospective meeting. That's the point where the improvement of the process is taking place. So the developers are talking about what was good, what was not good in the past sprint, and they are trying to do it better in the next sprint. Good. Go more into details. Scrum has three components, means that are different roles, artifacts, and meetings. And the first point are the roles I would like to present you. We have three roles. It's a product owner. I used some pictures from our team, so this product owner would be Georgie. I guess some of you know her because she's working close with Autodesk. The Scrum team are our developers. It's Jan, Philip, and Alex. And Scrum Master would be me in this case, so just to visualize it a little bit. Good. What is the role of the product owner? The product owner is responsible for the product backlog. This is his list where he's responsible to make the prioritization of the product backlog items. So he's talking to the customer, and he's a kind of interface to the customer and is prioritizing all the features in the list. And he's also a kind of mediator between customer and team. I guess every one of you who worked with some developers, you can see they are talking two different languages. If you talk to a sales guy or a marketing guy, or if you are talking to a developer, it's more technical, and the product owner have to talk both languages, a kind of. So that's his task, and it's very important because it's not easy sometimes to transfer the requirements from the market to a technical developer. And he is focused more on the what than on the how. Means he's not responsible to write technical tasks. It's important that he can write a good user story, that the developers do understand what's really the need for the market. That's the product owner. Let's come to the Scrum team. Scrum team is a functional group, and that means they are not individualists. It's in the Scrum team, it's not important that somebody is responsible for the front end, the other one is responsible for the design, the other one for testing. It's a cross-functional group where everyone is doing everything. So it means they are helping each other in a team, sharing their experiences, and provide in the end a potential shippable product. So means not as in waterfall that you do the testing in the end, you do the testing during the sprint, which brings a better quality to the product. They collaborate, and it's self-organizing. Means the product owner is not responsible to say, Jan, you're doing this task, or Philip, you're doing this task. The team is self-organizing, and they are just pulling the tasks out of the sprint backlog, and they organizing themselves. The Scrum Master is a Also a key figure, he has no management authority. It means he's also not responsible to give tasks to the team. He's more important to for the case that he's looking for the scrum processes, that meetings are time boxed, so that, for example, a 1 hour meeting is not taking longer. So he's teaching the scrum methodology to the team, to the product owner. So there's not really detailed focus on the project. It's more a focus on the process. And yeah, as I said, he doesn't have a project manager role, what I explained right now. And he's also a kind of facilitator. Means he's in between the team and the product owner. And if any trouble occurs or issues or impediments, the Scrum Master is the one who is a kind of interacting between these two groups. Okay. Let's go to the artifacts. Means Scrum has two artifacts. It's the first one is the product backlog, and the second one is the sprint backlog. That are the main parts. You could also create a stakeholder list and such things, but that's not so important. Important is at first explanation of the product backlog. As I said, the product owner is responsible for the product backlog, and he's responsible for the prioritization. Means one product backlog item has his single prioritization. It's not that, for example, five product backlog items have the priority one, the other seven have priority 0.5, or how it works sometimes at project management. It's every single product item has its own individual prioritization. It's product, for example, the most important one has one, the second two, three, four, until the product backlog is done. That makes it possible to define always the most important one, and later the team can grab just the most important features and implement it in the product. And you see it again, it's the how, what the product owner is about, not the what. That's wrong. It's the what, sorry. That's wrong. I just changed it. It's the what has to do. Good. I will show you a process how the product backlog could look like. So I prepared something from GP, from the project GP, and I prepared already two user stories, and it's, for example, one task was from Autodesk that we have to integrate languages, different languages. So the user story, it's always the same type of sentence. You have always, as a user, means who. I would like to be able to switch the page language to my native language. It's the what has to do. And why do we have to do it is to have a better understanding of the content of the GP tool. Then you have the prioritization. Story points is the estimation of the product backlog item. That will be estimated by the team, so there's no entry yet. You have a status. You have here a column where you can add the sprint where it will be implemented. And you have the acceptance criteria. Acceptance criteria is a kind of detailed explanation of the user story. So here are all the information which are needable to make this user story understandable for the team. So in the end, the team has to read this and have to understand what the meaning is. So such details need to be added to the product backlog. And to show it to you, the second one would be state field. As a user, I would like to be able to define my state or province when registering for an event to provide a more detailed localization. You have here also the who, the what, and the how. Good. Let's write a user story for the RSS feed, which was a requirement from Autodesk. It could be the user story, could be as a user. So who? It could also be at an admin user or at an Autodesk user or whatever. So the user can be also a person. So at the user, I would like to use RSS feeds to get quick access to all my events. That would be the user story. Very easy. The priority could be, okay, maybe the customer says, that's the most important one for me, so it's priority one, then I have here priority two and priority three. I can always change it, the prioritization. So it's very flexible, so that's why it's an agile project management type, because you can make a lot of changes because you have just iterations. You don't have to plan it from the beginning. And the acceptance criteria, I make it very quick, is linked to as feed with my events. So that's it. I forgot. So like this. And you see, it's I have just three detailed user stories, but I could have some more features already in the product backlog which are not defined yet. It's maybe not important if just the three will be implemented for the first sprint. So I hope that gave you a small overview about the product backlog. We will use it later too. So the second artifact is the sprint backlog. I will go more detailed into this during the meetings. I come back to the sprint backlog. You can see just the backlog items which the team were committed to, and they are writing subtasks to each product backlog item. And they can write it. Imagine it's a physical board, for example, where they have columns like not started, in progress done, and they pin their post-it just there what the process of the task right now is. Very important is these tasks are now very technical. So the team, the developers, will write the subtasks to implement the product. So they have to create technical tasks, and this is now the how part. Good, let's go into the meetings. That's also a very important part, because at Scrum you have a very structured meeting structure. Means that all the important meetings are in this process integrated. So it's very important that you also use these meetings to make Scrum successful. You have at first, you have the sprint planning meeting, where you're planning the sprints. You have the daily Scrum meeting, which is recurring every day during the sprint. It's 10 to 15 minutes. You have the sprint review meeting, where the team is providing the potential shippable product. And you have the sprint retrospective meeting, where you try to improve your processes. And this will be also recurring sprint by sprint. You will always have this meeting structure and this kind of improvement. And in between, you have the grooming meeting. It's called grooming meeting. You can also call it backlog refinement. It's at any time during the sprint, the team comes together with the PO, and they are having a look on the product backlog to get an overview what could be the next items during the next sprint, for example, or next two sprints. So it's a kind of meeting where they get an overview. Maybe you know this process already if you are a little bit aware of process improvements. It's the PDCA circle. It's called also the Deming circle. Is almost the same. So you start with planning, you do it, you check if the process is okay, and then you act. And you do it again and again to improve the processes. So Scrum is almost similar to this process. Let's explain you something more detailed, the meetings. The sprint planning meeting is the first one. The attendees are the product owner and the team. That's very important that in the sprint planning meeting, these two parties are attending. Again, you have here the product backlog, which is prioritized by the product owner. And I try to make it a little bit more visible that the team is just grabbing the product backlog items from the top. They are discussing each product backlog item with the product owner so that they get a complete understanding what they have to do. They ask questions. The product owner is trying to explain everything very detailed in addition to the acceptance criteria. So what the team is doing, they are grabbing all the user stories they can handle in one sprint. So they are committing to this work, that they can handle this in this 2 or 3 week sprints. And they have to estimate. After they discuss the product backlog item, they will estimate it. And here, it's a funny game. It's called planning poker. You see, it has different kind of numbers on the cards, and it's called the Fibonacci numbers, because it's not 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, so in a row. You have, as bigger the task is, as less detailed can be the estimation. So that's the reason why you have this number and this steps by the numbers. But you will see later that it's not so important that you estimate a task, for example, with, 18 hours. You can also handle it then with 20 story points in this way. You call it story points in Scrum, the estimation. I will explain it later. Good. What they are doing, the developers, is they are sitting around a table discussing the task. And once they are clear, it's clear what they have to do, everyone is putting at the same time a card on the table. And if they are close with the agreement, so that everyone would take the number 5, the product owner is estimating the task in a product backlog with 5 story points. If they are not close with an agreement, for example, one choose 2, the other one choose 20, the one developer who choose the lowest value, he's explaining why he is why he choose this card, and the one with the highest number is explaining why he's choosing such a big estimation. And maybe they have different knowledge about what have been done in former projects, or they are sharing just their knowledge, and maybe the one with the lowest one didn't know everything about this process. And so they are sharing their experiences. And in a second round of the planning poker, maybe they are closer. And the product owner can make the estimation. That leads to a more detailed estimation of the product backlog items, because all the knowledge, all the experiences of the developers are shared. Good. Let's come to sprint planning. I forget before, the sprint planning meeting is divided in 2 parts. The what part, it's this one, where the product owner is explaining the tasks, and the how part is where the developers are creating the subtasks to each product backlog item. So they have here the 4 items they committed to the product owner that they can implement it during this next sprint, and then they are creating subtasks and pin the post-its on the board. I have on the next slide. I can show you a sprint backlog how it could look like. So they transfer the user story to their sprint backlog. So the team is responsible for the sprint backlog. They are writing down the user story of the product backlog item. And then they're creating subtasks, technical tasks which they need for the implementation. You see, they choose these 3 user stories, and they were writing subtasks to each item. And now they are estimating the subtasks in hours, not anymore in story points. Now they are having a smaller package of the user story, which they can handle in the estimation in hours. Yeah. Good. Continue with a sprint goal. Sprint goal is also a part of the sprint planning meeting. Means the product owner is defining what he would like to have in the end of the sprint. It's not necessary that every task was finished in the sprint. It's more finished that the sprint goal is reached. I wrote down here a sprint goal for our project. It's called user gets a quick access to his events which are provided in his preferred language. That's the focus for the team, to say this we have to reach to make the sprint successful. It could be everything else depending on the product owner, and it will be defined for each sprint. Good. Let's go to the daily Scrum meeting. That are the team, the attendees is the team. The Scrum Master and the Product Owner is optional here. Means he can listen and can be updated. It's always also important for the Product Owner to see what's the status of the sprint is. So he can just listen. You will see it on the next slide. I demonstrated it. Everyone is standing around this task board with the post-it pins, and the development team is telling each other what they did yesterday, what they will do tomorrow or today until the next daily Scrum meeting, and do they have any impediments. The Scrum Master is listening. He's responsible to manage the impediments. So, for example, if the team is waiting for a text of a landing page or whatever from the Product Owner, and the Product Owner has not provided it yet, the Scrum Master is going after the daily meeting to this Product Owner and says, come on, you said you would provide the text. The team is waiting for it. So that's his role. And he is responsible for the time boxing. Means in this case, the meeting is 10 to 15 minutes. After 15 minutes, the Scrum Master will break up the meeting and say, okay, come back tomorrow and maybe we have to be more detailed tomorrow. So it's already an improvement process in this way. And the Product Owner is just listening. So I have here an example from a Scrum project from us here, an internal project, where we created a task board. We had a flip chart foil and wrote down the story points. And here we have the columns. It's the task, the to-do, it's in process, and it's done. So in a daily meeting, the team is just grabbing one task if he starts the process and put it in progress. Or if it's done, he put the post-it and put it into the column done. Here you have an overview what the status of the project is. In this case, we haven't started with the sprint, so here's no information into it, but you can see that's the average line. So if you are with your story points over the line, you are in delay. If you are under the line, you are good in time. Good. Sprint review meeting. It's the end of the sprint. In the sprint review meeting, you have the team and the Product Owner. And I visualized it with this car that the team is providing the shippable product. Means they are done with the sprint and they are demonstrating the software to the Product Owner. And as I said in the beginning, to this sprint review meeting, there could also be Autodesk, the customer, an attendee, or the management of the company, in this case Horst. They can also be participate in this meeting and have a look on the project, on this shippable part of this incremental part, to see in a very early version if it's the way they would like to have it, if the market would like to have it in this way, if the customer is satisfied with it, and they can say, okay, I liked it this way, so you can continue with the next product backlog items in the next sprint, or I don't like it, I would like to have additional requirements, and then the Product Owner just write down the new product backlog items and put it into the product backlog and prioritize it. If the customer is saying that's so important, what's right now not good in the project, then you prioritize it very high. So it will be implemented in the next sprint. So it's a very good part to bring a big flexibility or transparency into this process to provide everyone the current status. Yeah, and the sprint retrospective meeting. It's the team who is attending in this meeting. And as I said in the beginning, it's very important that they have a reflection on the last sprint, that they say, this part was very good, I liked it, and so we can go on and work like this, and there are parts I didn't like that we have to improve. So they are talking to each other. The Product Owner is not very necessary in this part. Here at One Media, we are inviting the Product Owner because it could also be that, for example, he has to improve the user stories or the acceptance criteria has to be more detailed. So for us, it's important that he is an attendee of the meeting, but usually it's within the team that they can organize themselves and that they can improve the process. I have here an example of the retrospective meeting, because you should document it. Because if you're just talking about it, I guess you know nothing will change. So you document it after each sprint and look in the second sprint in the end if you have the same points here or if you already improved your process. Yeah, let's see what are the details of this document. You have the sprint goal, which you just which you defined in the beginning of the sprint. You are looking if you reached this the sprint goal, if yes, with restrictions or no, and you enter the estimated story points. Maybe I can show it to you. We have here the product backlog. Oh, it's gone the user story. But for example, you had 20 user stories for the feature 1, you had 35 for feature 2, and you have 20 for the third one. You would describe it in the retrospective with 75 story points were estimated. For example, the team were not reaching this 75 story points. Maybe they missed, for example, the impression page or the contact information page. It's not a point that you say, I can't launch the product, but you just reached, for example, 60 story points. And then you can estimate your team velocity. The team knows in the next sprint, okay, 75 story points were too much. In the next sprints, we can just choose 60 story points. So if you have sprint 1, 2, 3, or 5, it's everything. Every time it gets more detailed that the team knows their velocity. So it's also an improvement for the time management. And as I said, you have here the part where you say what should remain the same. I have here some examples. The product owner was always available for questions and or very good communication within the team. What has to be changed? Maybe better automatic testing. It's just a fictive example. Or improvement of the user stories and acceptance criteria. And the third part is what do we have to start immediately? That could be, for example, that they developers have not the skills for automatic testing or not the entire skills. They need maybe a training. So the Scrum Master goes to the management and says, our Scrum team needs a training in automatic testing. So that was an example for the retrospective meeting. Let's go back to the presentation. That were the meetings of the sprint. And in the end, I have the last meeting. Last but not least, the grooming meeting, which I mentioned before, between the product owner and the team. It's that the team is having an overview about the product backlog during a sprint. This meeting can take place at any time during a sprint, and they are looking what are the next items in the product backlog, what are the most important items which could be necessary in the next sprint, and are they already detailed enough? Do we understand the tasks, or has the product owner maybe go back to the customer and ask him questions about these features? And they just get a complete overview about the tasks which are relevant for the next sprint or the next two or three sprints. Good. The last slide is I wrote down some essentials of Scrum. It's Scrum is a structures development in cycles of work called sprints. So as I said, it's iterations, which should be not longer than 1 month. So 2 or 4 weeks would be fine. But also, if you have a small project with 1 week, it's also possible. But usually, you should choose a sprint between 2 or 4 weeks. It's also important that the sprint is always the same length. So if you have a big project with several sprints, you shouldn't choose one sprint is 2 weeks, then other sprint is 3 or 4 weeks. You should remain always the same for the 2 week sprints, because then you have a real velocity. You know how much story points you can fulfill in one sprint. It makes it easier for the team to have this fixed time schedule. And also, very, very important, the team decides how many product backlog items they choose for the sprint. It's not that the product owner says, come on, I'm sure you will do it. Another task in this sprint, we need it absolutely. It's important that the team is giving their commitment. So it's important that they say we can do it without pressure of the product owner or the customer. It's not a problem if you can't do it in this sprint, because you don't have to wait 1 year until it is launched. You can do it in the next sprint. So you have to wait maybe just 2 weeks, and this, I guess, is handleable. So you get a better quality because you don't have this pressure. You're working in a team, share your experiences. And yeah, as I said, a sprint take place one after the other. It's a fixed duration, I already mentioned, and they end always on a specific date. Yeah, and it will never extend it. Yeah, time boxed. You will always hear the definition time boxed, because it's very important to stay on the process of Scrum. Good.